Hyderabad. He has gotten more than 100 publications to his credit. He is passionate about teaching to the postgraduate and fellowship students and DNB in neonatology too. So over to Dr. Srinivas Murthy to deliberate on non-invasive ventilation in a newborn in the present era. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. And at the outset, I want to thank the DIAP and also the executive of IAP for giving me this opportunity. And I'm sure these have become really one of the top most sought of lectures now in pediatrics and neonatology in the country now. So my topic is non-invasive ventilation in the newborn. Now, the objective of this presentation would be to make a case-based discussion. So I will talk on this topic based on a case, and I will try to see how best we can give non-invasive ventilation for newborns. Then when to use all the modes of non-invasive ventilation, what are the choices we have, and how do we use it? How do we initiate CPAP or other non-invasive? How do we monitor the baby on NIV? How do we wean? When do we say that we have failed on one mode and we need to switch to the other mode, either invasive or other mode of non-invasive mode of ventilation? And we'll also look at what can be done to improve the efficacy of non-invasive ventilation in the current scenario, and what are the learning options which as pediatricians or fellows, residents have to learn this process. So as I said, I'll go through this case and then try to see what best we can do for this child and different. I have taken the same child with two different scenarios. One where the baby improves and the other where the baby continues to struggle and then keeps on getting a different support. So we are talking about a 28-week, 1 kg, 1020 gram female child born preterm because of preterm labor, and there was no time for steroid coverage. So one dose of steroid was given 6 hours prior to delivery. It was a C-section delivery. There was no asphyxia. Baby started having respiratory distress soon after birth. So he was shifted to our tertiary care in ICU at 4 hours of after 4 hours of travel, and he was shifted on nasal oxygen. And this is a scenario which we see all over the country, that most of the babies who are to be delivered in tertiary care centers, because you expect all the VLVW babies to come and deliver in a place where good NICU facilities are available, or at least a good transport is available so that the baby remains on some support during the transport. So here the baby was on oxygen from admission till 4 hours. At admission to the NICU, the baby's temperature was 36. Luckily, there was not much of hypothermia, but there was cold stress. The baby had severe respiratory distress. Now, one very important method of scoring respiratory distress in preterm babies is called Silverman-Anderson score. I truly love this score because it will tell you the severity of lung inflation. So the atelectasis, the severity of atelectasis is marked by your Silverman-Anderson score. The higher the score, the more is the atelectasis, more is the alveolar collapse, and higher will be the need for pressure therapy or giving pressure to the lungs. And on oxygen, the baby was already maintaining normal saturation of 93%. So he's saying that here we are saying that baby is struggling, but he has on that respiratory distress, he has a normal saturation. So what do we do for this baby? He's preterm, he starts having distress, progressive, and by the time he reaches us, he has moderate to severe distress. So this is the baby which I'm talking about. So you can see there is nasal flaring. You can hear the grunt. You can see the upper chest. Upper chest is LH chest above the mid axillary line. Normally when we breathe, the chest and abdomen moves up. But here, the abdomen is moving up and the chest is caving inside. And there is some sternal retractions. And there is also some retractions in the... So if you look back, there are some retractions in the space below the mid-axillary line, that is lower chest. And you can easily see the nasal flaring from a distance. So this baby had grunting, nasal flaring, sternal retraction, not maybe two, maybe one, upper chest two, lower chest one. So if you look at this chart, you apply this chart to this baby, you can do a good Silverman. Upper chest, I say it were two because that abdomen was moving up and the chest was caving inside. So that gives a score of two. For the lower chest, that is below the mid-axillary line, there were retractions, but the retractions were not up to the axilla. They were low down in the baby, so score of 1. Xiphoid retractions, there were mild, so score of 1. There were nasal flaring. Maybe if you can appreciate, if you come down close to the baby, then you could see the nasal flaring. And if you're able to see from distance, then it becomes 2, but it is from when you look down to the baby, you could hear the nasal flaring. And you could hear the grunt, which was audible to you even without a stethoscope. So this baby qualifies for a score of 7 by 10. So the point I want to make out here is, although the baby is maintaining normal oxygenation, he's struggling. So this is an ideal candidate for a respiratory support. All preterm babies less than 35 weeks who are having respiratory distress, and if your Silverman score is more than 3 at birth, more than 3 at birth or in the first few hours or first 24 hours after birth, the baby is a candidate for CPAP or other non-invasive mode of ventilation. So in this baby, the upper chest was 2, lower chest was 1, xiphoid was 1, nasal flaring was 1, and grunting was 2. So total score was 7. So 7 is moderate to severe distress. Although he was maintaining saturation, this baby would require some sort of respiratory support. Oxygen is not sufficient for this baby. So this is the X-ray of the baby, which was done at admission. As you can see, very clear reticulogranular pattern. Both the lungs, there are reticulogranularity. The lung volume about 6.5 spaces. And you can see nice air bronchograms, which are going retrocardiac shadow. There are good air bronchograms. So this is looks like we have a baby with respiratory distress. And on the X-ray, we are confirmed that this looks like an RDS picture. So in a preterm baby, less than 35 weeks, if the baby has respiratory distress, starting at birth, progressing, and if you have an X-ray like this, it's almost a case of RDS, that is respiratory distress syndrome, or classically or historically called as HMD. So what respiratory support this baby would require? How do we give this support? And what do we monitor when we give this support? Now the respiratory support which we can give to this baby, so this, since he qualifies for a preterm baby less than 35, his score is more than 3, he has respiratory distress. So this is called primary respiratory distress. We are not talking about etiology when you say primary. It is that the respiratory distress starting at birth or at admission. He was not on any other respiratory support except oxygen prior to our admission. That's why it's called primary respiratory distress. The underlying etiology here is RDS, but it could be pneumonia, it could be TTN, or it could be other diagnosis also. So the support this baby will require is CPAP. How can we give CPAP? Either with bubble or ventilator or a flow driver. So this baby is asking for us to give either bubble CPAP or any other mode of CPAP with a good interface. So the interface for a flow driver is different from the interface which can be used for bubble or ventilator CPAP. I will try to show this in the next slide. Also, the other mode you can do is nasal IMV. So one can argue that for this baby, either it could be CPAP or it could be a nasal IMV. Nasal IMV is as effective as bubble CPAP for this baby. But as clinician, we would like to do cost-effective therapy. As Dr. Baswaraj just pointed out, we want to do a cost-effective therapy. That is why we will prefer to do CPAP rather than doing nasal IMV. But if facilities are available, if you don't have a CPAP machine, you can... Or if you already have a ventilator, you can easily do nasal IMV, which is almost like CPAP, but you are also adding, along with PEEP, you are adding PEEP in nasal IMV. So, but I would prefer for this baby to get only a CPAP. Now you can give CPAP with any one of the three machines shown upper part. So you can use a bubble CPAP. This is also a bubble CPAP from a different company. Or you can use a ventilator also for giving CPAP. So you can put the ventilator on a CPAP mode and give CPAP, or you can use any one of these companies which provide good bubble CPAPs. So what does a bubble CPAP has? Bubble CPAP should have a compressed oxygen source, compressed air source, a blender, a flow meter, a humidifier, and you have this warm humidified gases going to the patient and an expiratory limb which is going to dip inside a bubble chamber. So this is what a CPAP machine has normally. A CPAP machine requires air, oxygen, blender, flow meter, humidification, and a pressure generator. Here is a bubble CPAP or a bubble. So in a ventilator, it is going to be an obstructive wall, which is going to be there in the expiratory limb. So that generates a pressure in a ventilator. The bubbles generator develops, gives the pressure in a bubble CPAP. So this is the machine we can use. Any one of this machine you can use. And interfaces. Now you have a lot of choices in the interface. This is a Hudson prong. So you can use an Hudson prong or you can use a nasal mask. These are binasal prongs. This is a nasal mask. And off late, people are using more and more of Rahm's cannula, which is almost looks like a normal nasal cannula, but it is a wide bow and the cannula, the nasal cannula almost cover the nose. They're not covering, we can use a tegaderm. You can see, a duoderm, which is placed on the nose, and on the duoderm, you're placing this nasal cannula so that there is no leak around the nares. So you have three choices. You can use a binasal prong, you can use a mask, or you can use a Rahm's cannula. All are equally acceptable and depends on the unit. So if you have started using Hudson prong, continue to use it so that you learn the art in it. So I would suggest we will use a bubble CPAP and any one of the interface for this baby. Normally we avoid Rahm's cannula for less than 1 kg, but more than 1 kg, any one of the three interfaces are good. So since this baby is more than 1 kg, we can use any one of the three interfaces here. Now, how do we give it? We chose to start bubble CPAP and let's start using, so let's say use Hudson prongs. So how do we start bubble CPAP for this baby? So I'll show you the video of how to set a bubble CPAP. So all of you can see this. The preparation includes assembling the machine, bubble CPAP circuit, a cloth and a disinfectant for cleaning the machine, gloves and distilled water. Clean the machine with 2% Sidex or any other approved disinfectant. Clean the heater wire and temperature probe with a clean and soft cloth and sterilium.
Just wait, I'll restart.
Connect the preparation includes assembling the machine, bubble CPAP circuit, a cloth and a disinfectant for cleaning the machine, gloves and distilled water. Clean the machine with 2% Sidex or any other approved disinfectant. Clean the heater wire and temperature probe with a clean and soft cloth and sterilium. Connect the machine to compressed source of air and oxygen. After washing hands and wearing clean gloves, open the disposable CPAP circuit. Fix the water chamber onto the servo humidifier and fill it with distilled water. Use the autofill option of fixing the distilled water bottle to a stand for filling the water chamber. Fill the bubble chamber with clean or distilled water and fix it to a slot available on the CPAP machine stand. Now fit the safety device between the flow meter and the water chamber of humidifier using the green gas tubing. Now connect the blue inspiratory limb to the other port of the water chamber. To the other end of the blue inspiratory limb, lock the white expiratory limb of the bubble CPAP circuit. The second end of the expiratory limb is connected to the bubble chamber. Fix the heater wire and the temperature probe to the appropriate slots available in the humidifier and the inspiratory limb of the bubble CPAP circuit. Switch on the humidifier and set in invasive mode as shown here. Watch for bubbling in the bubble chamber. Set the FiO2 flow and pressure to appropriate level. Wait for the humidifier to display a temperature of 37 before connecting the circuit to the patient. So that is how we will start the machine. then I will show you how to fix the interface. So we are ready with the machine. Now we start the interface.
Assemble the Hudson prongs of appropriate size, gloves, green sheet, scissors, rubber bands, safety pins, tegger dam, and few connectors. Find the Hudson prongs, Velcro, and connectors in the prongs kit. Cut a strip of tegger dam. Open the Velcro. Cut the soft Velcro which is to be fixed on the prongs. Cut the rough Velcro of appropriate shape which will form the base on the philtrum. Fit the soft Velcro onto the prongs on either sides of the prongs. Close the pressure pot on the prongs with a sterile cap. Fix the connectors to the prongs. Now fix the cap to the head of the baby, ensuring that the ears are properly covered. Fix the tegger dam and the rough Velcro on the philtrum to form a base as shown in the video. Insert the nasal prongs into the nostrils and fix them to the base. The soft Velcro on the prongs locks with the rough Velcro on the philtrum. Connect the limbs of the circuit to the ends of the nasal prongs. Now fix the connectors to the cap on either side using the safety pins and the rubber bands. The rubber bands are made in a figure of 8 for fixing the connectors onto the cap. Now give support to the tubings by placing a green sheet under them. Insert an orogastric tube and fix the end of the tube to the sidewall of the incubator. Keep the end of the orogastric tube open. Now watch through the gas flow for any leaks in the circuit. Set flow and FiO2. Water in the humidifier chamber. Temperature on the humidifier. The heater wire and heater wire probes. Ensure that there is some distance between the prong and columella. The expiratory limb inserting into the bubble chamber. Watch for the bubbling and water level and also check for the set pressure in the bubble chamber.
Okay. Okay, so we have seen how to give, how to start the machine, how to fix the interface. So we have decided to start this baby on Bubble CPAP with Hudson prongs. Now we also seen that we have some knobs to be set and some adjustment to be made. Now let's look at what we have to do after we put the baby on CPAP. So there are only three knobs in CPAP. One is the CPAP, the pressure knob. FiO2, how much of oxygen you are giving to give, fractional inspired oxygen, and the flow rate. Normally, when a baby has respiratory distress and you are starting CPAP, that means the lungs are collapsed. You are trying to open the lungs with some pressure. So use a pressure of 5. You start with an FiO2 of 30% and a flow rate of 5 liters per minute. So this is your starting. Now, how do you know that your FiO2 pressure of 5 is adequate? How do you know that your FiO2 30% is appropriate and flow is appropriate or not? Now, for that, you know that the pressure requirement is for opening of the alveoli, or atelectatic lung has to open up. So what are the features of atelectasis in a preterm baby? If a baby's lungs are atelectatic, he is going to have respiratory distress. He has tachypnea, he has retraction, that is intercostal or upper chest, lower chest retraction, sternal retraction, nasal flaring, and grunting. So these are the signs which tells you that there is atelectasis, there is a need for pressure. So if there are signs of atelectasis, or there are signs of, or seen on the Silverman-Anderson score, that means the baby needs pressure. So you start with a pressure of 5, look for the decrease in these recessions, decrease in Silverman-Anderson score. If it's happening, that means your pressure is adequate. Wait for 15 to 30 minutes. If the Silverman-Anderson score remains same, grunting remains, or if the retractions worsen, then you increase the pressure from 5 to 6. So depending upon how the baby's alveoli are, your aim will be to open the alveoli by using this pressure called CPAP pressure. Now the second component of FiO2. You start with FiO2 30% and you aim for a saturation of 91 to 95% or 90 to 95%. If your saturation are less than 90%, that means you need more oxygen. How can you give more oxygen to the lungs? Either by opening the lungs or by giving more FiO2. So if the lungs are already open, that means the retractions are minimal or there are no retractions, you increase the FiO2. If lungs are not open, continue to have retractions, our aim to give oxygen is to improve the lung expansion. So increase the pressure. So if you have low saturation and retractions, you will increase the CPAP pressure. But if you have low saturation and no retractions, we'll increase the FiO2 from 30 to 35 and 35 to 40 in that stepwise manner. Now, how do we know that flow of 5 liters is appropriate or not? Flow is to generate pressures. So if your flow of 5 is able to develop bubbles in the bubble chamber, that means the pressure which you want to give, whatever pressure, 5 or 6, if you want to give that pressure, whether it is reaching in the circuit or not, you can know from looking at the bubbles in the bubble chamber. If bubbles are available in the scene in the bubble chamber, means your pressure of 5 is delivered to the circuit. So bubbles in the bubble chamber will tell you that your flow rate is appropriate. If your saturation is between 91 to 95%, will tell you if FiO2 is appropriate. And your pressure is appropriate if you start seeing the decrease in retractions, decrease in SA score, and secondarily supported by your chest X-ray. So normal chest X-ray shows 6 to 8 spaces. If you have less than 6 spaces, white out lung, the cardiac borders are not well seen. That means there is more atelectasis, there is more need for pressure. So clinically, SA score and retractions and X-ray are the features which will tell you that, okay, there is a need for increasing pressure. Now between pressure and FiO2, which you have to increase? If there is low saturation, if there are low saturation and retractions are there, you will increase the pressure. If the saturations are low but retractions are not there, you will start increasing the FiO2. FiO2 is increased in steps of 5%. Pressure is increased in steps of 5 to 6 to 7. So when saturation is low with retractions, increase CPAP. When saturation is low with improved retractions, increase the FiO2. If SpO2 is more than 95%, that means you are achieved the normal saturation and you're going up above the normal saturation and respiratory support. If your saturation is more than 95% and baby has no or mild retractions, reduce the FiO2. So once the baby improves, when the lungs open up, the oxygen requirement will come down. So when the oxygen requirement is coming down, no retractions means lungs are open up. So your oxygen requirement starts coming down. Suppose you went on a CPAP of 7 and FiO2 of 60%. Now after 12 hours, your lungs are showing good inflation. No retractions or mild retractions, saturations are above 95%. So you keep coming down on the FiO2 to as low as less than 30%. So from 60, you will come to 55, 50, 45, 40. In that manner, you will come to less than 30%. Once your FiO2 is less than 30%, if there are no retractions, you come down on your CPAP pressure from 7 to 6. And still there are no retractions, good saturations, you come from 6 to 5. And once you come to a pressure of 5 and FiO2 less than 30, you come down on the FiO2 to less than 25%. And if still baby is showing good saturation of 90 to 95%, there are no or mild retractions, you decrease the pressure from 5 to 4. So once a baby is on pressure of 4, FiO2 25 or less than 25%, the baby is telling that my alveoli are open. I do not require much of more pressure support. So try to take me off from CPAP or remove from a pressure support, and you can give now a non-pressure support. That could be a HFNC or could be a plain nasal oxygen or room air. Now in this scenario, the infant was started on bubble CPAP with binasal prongs. We have seen that. He was started on a pressure of 5, FiO2 to 30% and a flow of 5 liters. Now, once you start the baby on CPAP, you get an X-ray within half an hour or maybe 30 minutes. In that time, you should try to get X-ray. A baby on CPAP, if a X-ray suggests you of RDS, so you add on with CPAP, you add on surfactant. Now, how surfactant will help? Surfactant will help in preventing alveolar atelectasis. Pressure CPAP opens up, surfactant is given, so it will prevent the collapse of atelectatic alveoli. So CPAP with surfactant should be given as early as possible to prevent atelectasis and to prevent lung injury. So this baby was started on CPAP and X-ray was showing RDS. So he was given surfactant by Insure method. Insure means intubate, give surfactant, extubate and put him back onto the CPAP machine. So what we have seen is over the next 1 hour, the SA score decreased to 4/10. FiO2 was 30%, still flow rate of 5 liters per minute. On this, the retractions decrease means your pressure is working and your surfactant is working. From 7, we have come down to 4. FiO2 30% and saturations are normal. So flow rate of 5 means your pressure, you are able to deliver the pressure with whatever pressure of 5, your lungs are opened up and pressure is delivered to the circuit. Over the next 12 hours, the SA score decreased to 1/10. So almost reduced, mild retractions. Saturations are improved, so FiO2 was brought down to 25%. Flow rate continued to be 5 liters because you, whatever pressure you are giving, if you want to deliver that to the baby, you want to give the same flow rate. So what is the plan now? So now you have a baby on already on 5, 30%. From 30% we came to 25%. Now on flow of 5 liters, you are able to deliver everything correctly. So now you decrease the pressure from 5 to 4. And if they're on 4 also, if there are no retractions, baby is maintaining good saturation, then we need to either take this baby onto HFNC or continue CPAP till the baby's retractions completely decreases. So if a baby is more than 1 kg, the baby like this who's more than 1 kg, once he comes on pressure of 4, FiO2 to 25%, we would shift him to high flow nasal cannula. But if the baby is less than 1 kg, because the atelectasis, small atelectasis can cause trouble for these small babies, we'll continue to keep the baby on CPAP till the retractions come down. And sometimes we give a trial of CPAP, and by removing CPAP, if the baby starts having apnea or if the baby has distress setting again, we continue the baby on same setting of CPAP till apnea has become passive, till retractions become normal, or till baby comes to 21% oxygen. Less than 1 kg, we'll continue the baby on CPAP. More than 1 kg, now we can turn the baby from CPAP to high flow nasal cannula. Apart from surfactant and CPAP, this baby also requires caffeine and also should be started on minimal enteral nutrition. This should not be forgotten because they are adjunct to therapies which are going to help these babies a lot in preventing infection and also improving the respiratory outcomes. So this baby, since he's more than 1 kg, he was started on HFNC, but less than 1 kg, I said you continue CPAP till pressure is 4 centimeters and FiO2 is 21%. If apneas occur after removal, continue on CPAP till apnea resolves. For a 700 to 800 gram baby, this may take about a week or maybe more than a week also till apneas become passive. And this baby may require only minimal setting CPAP of 4 and 21% till apnea has become passive or till that small atelectasis results in this extreme preterm babies. But in this baby, we are going to start the baby on HFNC. Now, how do we give HFNC? HFNC is given with the same machine which we have used for same machine which we have used for the CPAP. So I'm showing how to start HFNC for the baby. Since our baby is more than 1 kg, we'll start HFNC for this baby.
In this video, we shall learn how to fix heated, humidified, high flow nasal cannula or H3 FNC interface for a newborn baby. H3 FNC is defined as the use of thin, tapered binasal prongs to deliver gas flows greater than 1 liter per minute. The first step is to correctly identify the appropriate size H3 FNC cannula. Cannula of different sizes can be identified using cannula size gate. The different sizes available are red color for premature babies, yellow for neonates, and violet for infants. The second step involves attaching air and oxygen tubing to the central supply and to the blender. The tubing from
should be the same
value if the baby is on another.
So because baby is already on CPAP, we continue to use
non-invasive respiratory extubation. The fire is set at 37 degrees Celsius. The other end of tubing is connected to nasal cannula. Always.
So that was the only difference, that the inspiratory limb is directly connected to the cannula, whereas in CPAP, we had the inspiratory limb connected going to the nasal interface, and from the nasal interface, the expiratory limb was going to bubble chamber. Here, we don't have an expiratory limb and a bubble chamber. To the inspiratory limb, we are directly connecting the nasal interface.
Nasal cannula. Always begin gas flow prior to applying device to the baby. The third step is to correctly place the patient connections. First, place a thin strip of Tegaderm over the nasal septum and over upper lip. Place H3 FNC cannula over nasal septum. Insert the prongs into the patient's nares and secure the cannula to the face using adhesive Velcro as shown.
So that's all. So there is not much difference. We have seen that it is almost the same, that the machine is the same, the parts of the machine are the same. From the inspirate limb of that blue tubing, we remove the interface of CPAP and fix the nasal cannula of HFNC, and that cannula goes into the nose. Now, what is the difference in cannula of a CPAP versus HFNC? In CPAP, the nasal cannula fits snugly into the nose. There is no air leak around the nares. In HFNC, the prongs, the nasal prongs are very small. They are tapered to the end and they occupy less than 50% of the nose. So there is a lot of leak which is allowed around the nostrils in HFNC. You do not allow leak around the nose, nares in CPAP, but you allow significant leak around the nares in HFNC. So in the current context, the best therapy which you can give for a baby coming out from CPAP or when the CPAP setting decreases is HFNC. So when we start HFNC for a baby, we continue the same flow rate. Since the baby required FIO2 of 25%, we can continue on the same 25%. And subsequently, we can decrease FIO2 to as low as 21% if your saturations are more than 91%. And how do we taper the HFNC? Now, if the baby is on 21% oxygen flow of 5 liters, and if the baby continues to maintain good saturations, you come down on the FIO2 to as low as 21%. Once the baby is on FIO2 of 21%, there are no retractions. We have removed him from CPAP when there are no retractions. There are continues to be no retraction to decrease the flow rate from 5 to 4, 4 to 3, 3 to 2. Once the baby comes to a flow rate of 2, FIO2 to 21%, this baby is now ready to come to room air. So you can take out the HFNC and give room air. There is nothing else to be done on this baby. So now that was how we manage the baby who has improved dramatically after giving surfactant and CPAP. Within 12 hours, we have seen dramatic decrease in the requirement for CPAP. And the baby from CPAP came to HFNC. Within the next 48 hours, baby also came out of HFNC to room air. So this was a classical presentation of a baby with RDS. I will take one more scenario of the same case. Now, let us assume that the same baby, less than 35 weeks, has severe distress, reaches at 4 hours, and continues to maintain a saturation of 95% at admission. And this baby was started on bubble CPAP with binasal prong, CPAP pressure of 5, same what we have done. So now the baby is started on pressure of 5, flow of that 5 liters, FiO2 to 30%. And this baby, again, X-ray was showing RDS, so we started him on surfactant by Ensure method. Now, what happened for the baby over the next 3 hours? Now, SA score remained the same. The retractions did not come down. The baby continued to have upper chest, lower chest, sternal, some nasal flaring and grunting also. So, as the retractions remained the same in spite of giving pressure of 5 and surfactant, the CPAP pressure was gradually increased from 5 to 6 and 6 to 7. And FiO2 also was increased from 30% over time till 60%, from 30 to 35, 35 to 40, because the baby was maintaining always borderline saturations. Flow was always kept at 5 liters because bubbles were always seen in the bubble chamber. Now, once the baby came to on a pressure of 7 and FiO2 of 60% and flow rate of 5, the Silverman underscore decreased. There was some decrease to over the next year by 5 by 10. So, but the pressure remained the same and baby still has high FiO2 flow rate. Now, on this setting, the nurse noted that the retractions are not coming down. Now, it is from 3 hours. For the next 12 hours, the baby continues to have retractions of 5. So, from 7, it decreased to 5. But subsequently, there was no reduction in FiO2 and no reduction in reduction in the retractions. So, what do we plan now? Now, before we plan anything, we have to ensure that this pressure is actually reaching the lung. So how do we know that this pressure which you are giving 7 centimeters is reaching the lung? So the pressure is reaching the circuit, you know, by looking at the bubbles in the bubble chamber. But if you are able to get this pressure to the lungs, you should auscultate on the bilateral axilla. If in the axilla, if the bubble sounds are heard, that means this pressure of 7 is actually reaching the lung. So the way to look at it is, pressure reaching the circuit is by looking at the bubbles in the bubble chamber. Pressure reaching the lung is bubbling sounds heard in the chest. So we have to go through this protocol to ensure that our pressure or CPAP is adequately given for this baby before we say that our CPAP is not working. So if there are no leaks in the circuit, there will be bubbling in the bubble chamber. If bubbles are heard in the chest, there is air is reaching the lung and the pressure is actually reaching the lung. And we should also ensure that the humidification is appropriate. How do you know humidification is appropriate? By looking at, there is no condensation in the inspirate limb. The chamber temperature always shows 37 on the monitor, on the humidity monitor or humidification monitor. The nasal interface, the seal should be appropriate and the fixation should be good. There should not be any blanching, there should not be any snubbing, and there should not be any weight of the prongs falling on the nose. And you can repeat an X-ray because by this time, 12 hours, retractions have not come down. You are already given high pressure. You are given surfactant. So lung inflation now was 7 spaces. There was retinoglandularity was still present, but there was no pneumothorax. Some other causes like a acute onset pneumonia, or if worsening of distress, our surfactant and CPAP is not able to resolve the RDS completely. So all this can be seen on the X-ray. ECHO was done, which has shown pulmonary hypertension. So there was a PPHN now of TRZ of 40. So we have a baby with RDS, improved little bit, but continues to have distress and continues to have low saturation, requires high FiO2. And we are seeing that ECHO is showing PPHN now. And however, there is no pneumonia, but there are reticular calamity, means lung is still not inflated completely. So what do we do now? The baby was given, since it was only 12 hours, the baby was given a second dose of surfactant and continued on CPAP. So for management of PPHN, the hypoglycemia, we should look for hypoglycemia, hypocalcemia, anemia, polycythemia, and acidosis. These are reversible causes of PPHN. So this baby had transient cold stress, so we recovered that. And he was, all the other things which can cause PPHN were controlled. Fluids were given for this baby and anatropic support was started, dobutamine, and one dose of Lasix was given as IVC was full. So one should relieve the pain, so there should not be any abdominal distension. The nasal cannula should be well fitting. The baby should not be struggling. All this was taken care of and humidity was well maintained. So after doing all this, since the retractions continued, pressure requirement was 7, FiO2 was 60%, and baby continued to have distress. X-ray showed that there is still some amount of RDS, and echo is showing PPHN. A decision was made that the baby has failed CPAP. So before labeling CPAP, we have given the best support. We have ensured that what we are giving is reaching the baby, and we have ruled out the other complications, saying that we have done everything else before saying the baby has failed CPAP. So the baby has failed CPAP. He has required high pressure, high oxygen, and still requiring having low saturation, still having retractions. So we can't go more than 7 and we can't go more than 60. Some people go up to 7, 8 to 9 pressures and FiO2 more than 60 also. But we prefer not to use more than 7 pressure and FiO2 more than 60. So this is a failed CPAP. Now your choices are, either you can put this baby on nasal IMV or intubate the baby and put him on ventilation. So two options. There are many people who will like to put nasal IMV. If you are experienced in doing nasal IMV, you should do nasal IMV for this baby, because all that you do is with the same interface, same circuit, instead of the bubble CPAP machine, you take the ventilator, connect the inspirator limb and expirator limb of the CPAP circuit to the ventilator and set the baby on nasal IMV, which is giving in pressure, PIP and P pressure, and increasing FiO2. So what did it do in this baby? So now we have started NIMV in this baby because it was a rescue mode of failed CPAP. Now we said we had two choices for this baby when we start having respiratory distress. This baby came with respiratory distress. You could start with CPAP or nasal IMV. We preferred CPAP in the beginning, and now CPAP has failed. Now we are taking off nasal IMV. We could have started with nasal IMV in the beginning rather than using nasal IMV now. So both choices are acceptable. And in fact, the evidence says both are equally effective for starting CPAP or nasal IMV. But cost-wise, CPAP is better in the starting. And if CPAP fails, you go to nasal IMV. So nasal IMV here is a rescue mode because baby failed CPAP. He was started nasal IMV, same interface, but connected to the ventilator. The pressures here were 5 to 6 centimeter pressure. PIP was 16 to 18. TI of 0.4, rate of 40, flow of 6 to 8 liters, and FiO2 was same as that as he failed on CPAP. So on nasal IMV, for PEEP, we should watch the recessions, and for PIP, you can look for chest rise like what we do in a conventional ventilation. And for SpO2, you should ensure that there is a saturation of 91 to 95%. So we should expect the baby's retraction to come down. The air entry should be good. Breath sound should be heard. And saturation should be between 91 to 95% if babies have succeeded on nasal IMV. So since the baby failed CPAP, we are using nasal IMV as a rescue mode of CPAP, as a rescue mode of ventilation. I will show you the video of how to start the nasal IMV, and then we will end with the case scenario here. So it is the same baby, same settings, instead of connecting. So this same baby now is connected with the same interface, inspirator limb and expirator limb. So is now connected to the ventilator, and ventilator in the CPAP mode initially, and he can go to the nasal IMV mode. So there is not much difference except that the circuit is now connected to ventilator in place of CPAP machine. So you can use now nasal IMV for this baby. So we have, for the same machine, initially we started on CPAP, from there we went to HFNC. And for a baby who has improved, for a baby who has deteriorated, we have used the same circuit, but instead of the bubble CPAP machine, we have shifted him to ventilator for giving nasal IMV. So subsequently, this baby was managed on nasal IMV. Baby's PPHN has resolved, the retractions came down, and the baby was shifted. The settings on nasal IMV came down to as low as 14/4. FiO2 came down to 21%. The flow was continued on 6 liters to 8 liters, and the baby was removed from nasal IMV to HFNC again. So the summary of management of nasal IMV in this case, as we have seen, is CPAP is a primary respiratory support for infants with respiratory distress or with infants with recurrent apneas or post-extubation. If the baby is ventilated and removed, you can start this baby on CPAP. NIMV, if facilities exist, it can be used exactly in the same conditions like CPAP or as a rescue for failed CPAP, as we see in the case scenario. HFNC, we prefer to use for post-CPAP or in babies who do not have much of retraction, but only oxygen and FiO2 requirement, HFNC is a good therapy. It is a good therapy for post-extubation and post-CPAP. So post-extubation, it can be an alternative to CPAP or nasal IMV, especially in babies more than 1 kg. So that is the summary of nasal IMV management. Now, look a few more slides on how do we increase the use of HFNC or CPAP, HFNC or NIMV. How do we improve the care of nasal invasion, non-invasive ventilation? So first thing is our interface should be appropriate. Whatever interface you are using, mask, RAM or Hudson, you should know how to use it and you should know how to fix it. Use the correct CPAP machine. I would prefer always a bubble CPAP, simplest to use. But a bubble CPAP machine is one which has compressed air source, compressed oxygen, should have a blender and a good humidifier which delivers the gas at 37 degrees with servo humidification. You should ensure appropriate humidification in all non-invasive ventilation in newborn. The temperature of the gas reaching the nose should be 37, not 35 or less than 35 as seen in adults. In newborns, it is always 37 humidification and there should not be any condensation in the inspirate limb. Monitor the baby interface and the machine for ensuring that all your non-invasive ventilation is going appropriate. We should try to simplify the settings so that people are easy. It is easy to apply. So we follow a rule of 5. Always start with a pressure of 5, flow of 5 for babies who have respiratory distress. And you titrate the FiO2 to get a saturation of 91 to 95%. Know the troubleshoot and use adjuvant therapies like caffeine and surfactant as early as possible if the baby is on CPAP. And again, start CPAP. If you start CPAP early in the delivery room, the moment baby starts having distress, you start CPAP, your efficacy is going to be better. Always should have a backup for ventilation, or if you don't have ventilation, there should be prepared for referral, because 10 to 15% of babies who are less than 1.5 fail CPAP or nasal IMV and may need ventilation. So going one by one to improve the efficacy, as I said, you have different interfaces, Hudson prongs, Rams cannula for babies more than 1 kg, less than 1 kg, you can try to use this mask, very good. They cause less injury and Rams cannula is easy, but use with the duoderm and also fix it such a way that there is no leak around the nostrils. Machine wise, always the machine should have a compressed air source, compressed oxygen source, blender, a flow meter, a servo humidifier set at 37, a inspirator limb with as a heater wire inside it and a pressure generator like a bubble generator here. Now, if you are not using bubble CPAP, you can use flow driver CPAP where the interface is totally different. It is not. The interface is the pressure generator in flow drivers. There should not be any condensation in the inspirator limb, as inspirator limb is this blue tubing where there should not be any condensation or water settling. If water settles in the inspirator limb, means your humidification is not appropriate. And you can start doing kangaroo mother care also if the baby is on CPAP. So this is a monitoring chart. A monitoring chart will involve baby's parameter which you have to monitor: heart rate, respiratory rate, CFT, Silverman score, breath sounds, urine output, girth, and CPAP which you are giving, and the FiO2. Then patient specific, like the nasal interface, you have to monitor how much distance is there between the columella and the interface, whether the nasal skin is all right or not, whether the columella is all right or not. You have to do frequent suctioning of the nose, ensuring that there is no block in the nose. And OG tube should always be in situ to prevent CPAP belly or nasal IMV belly. And this end of the tube should be open and should be fixed above the level of the tummy. In the machine part, always look for bubble, should always be continuous in the bubble chamber if you're using bubble CPAP. Temperature on the machine should be displaying 37. Tubing should be kept below the level of the patient, that the bubble chamber should be kept below the level of the chamber, baby, and flow should be always set at 5 liters per minute, very rarely more than 7 or 8 liters. So you should simplify by using a simple chart like this. In all the SNCUs in the government now, they have this chart. So this is a bubble CPAP chart. It tells you when to start. In each setting, babies with distress, apnea, and post-extubation, what settings you start with, and how do you manage the baby on CPAP, how do you change the CPAP, how do you change the FiO2, when do you change CPAP, and when do you change FiO2, how do you monitor the baby with interface, baby and the machine, when do you wean, and when do you say baby has failed CPAP. It also shows a picture of Silverman-Anderson score, monitoring chart, and also the troubleshoot. So simplify the use of CPAP so that more people can use CPAP and more nurses can use CPAP. This is a chart showing how we can just do an algorithmic management of CPAP for babies who have respiratory distress. So this is the last chart which shows the troubleshoot. Now this troubleshoot helps us to say what is the problem so that we can take appropriate action. If you have hypoxia, that is last saturation is low and there are retractions. And if air entry is poor, that means you are not able to hear the bubble sounds. But bubbling is there in the bubble chamber. What does it mean? It means that the pressure is there in the tube, but the pressure is not reaching the lungs. If the pressure is reaching the lungs, you should hear the bubble sounds in the chest. So the pressure is not reaching the lungs. Some problem is there in the nose. There is a block in the nose, or the lung disease has worsened. The severe distress is whatever pressure you're giving to the baby is not adequate. So increase the pressure. If there is hypoxia, no retractions, air entry is good, that means bubble sounds are heard in the chest, bubbling is seen. So pressure is there in the circuit, pressure has reached the lung. That is why there are no retraction, baby is still hypoxic. Means either baby is having a heart disease or a PPHN, or your blender is not working well. You are giving say 30%, but blender is giving only 21%. So you need to cross check the blender function. The last scenario, if you are having hypoxia, severe retractions, air entry is poor and there is no bubbles heard in the bubble seen in the bubble chamber. If there are no bubbles in the bubble chamber, means the pressure is not built in the tube. If the pressure is not built in the circuit, obviously it will not go to the lung. So you have to ensure that there are no leaks in the circuit or your flow is inadequate. So this is a condition where you don't get pressure in the tube. There is condensation in the inspirator limb, your heater wire is not working, or your room temperature is too low, or distal circuit, or the last part of the circuit is not under warmer. And you should expect some mist in the expiratory limb. If you are not seeing that, humidifier is still not working or room temperature is very high. So if you still want to learn more on non-invasive ventilation, there are a lot of options. You have this preterm care package. I'm not going to show it, but you can go to Google and type this word preterm care -eliminatingrop.com. You register here. You can learn the entire preterm care as well as CPAP. Whatever videos I've shown, all that videos are there in this package. Or you can go to YouTube, you can check for my name and type Srinivas Murki and YouTube. You can look at the bubble CPAP, how to apply, how to ensure that the baby is given appropriate CPAP. Or you can buy a CPAP book module from Noble Books, or you can attend one of our CPAP workshops. And best would be to observe for 15 to 30 days in a unit which does a lot of CPAP. Thank you.
So excellent, Dr. Srinivas Murki. It was something wonderful. And it was, as I bolte hai na, haath pakad ke sikhaya. So it was excellent. And I'm sure everybody has enjoyed learning from you and maybe hearing from you. So I'm very sure there must be many questions. So I will request Dr. Basavaraj and Mahesh to take up the question answer.
Murki, can you... you remote this thing. Fantastic. Actually, it was as Akul sir said,